Hello everybody, it's Claire here from Sewn by Claire, and we're on the next stage now of our doll, Clara the cat. Here she is in all of her glory, unclothed glory at the moment, and we're ready to start making her clothes. So just to backtrack slightly, I'm working on Clara the cat, which is this kit here, which was gifted to me by Lilly Rose Dolls. And Clara the cat is from the Apple Blossom Woodland collection of animals, and there's a whole range of characters for these, and they come with the felt body, and then also they've got all the detail, all the fabric in here for making the outfit. In this case it's bloomers, dress, pinafore and a hat. And I'm really enjoying this box actually, because it's really keeping everything together for me, which is great. And then at the end I'm going to just stack this up on my bookshelf, and then I'll have them along there and I'll be able to see which one I'm working on. I'm digressing. So I just want to say thank you to Claire and Richard, who have sponsored the video for me by providing me with the kit. And I was absolutely thrilled as soon as I saw these characters. I thought they were so cute, and I really wanted to give it a go. The other thing is they're freestanding. I can get it to balance, look on my hand. How clever is that? So these characters are freestanding. They don't have to sit all the time. Obviously you can sit if you want. The buttons I've added on, that's not part of a kit, but that's just because I'm used to doing buttons onto the joints. So ignore the buttons, because the buttons don't come as part of the kit. But you'll have some in your stash anyway, I'm sure. So I just want to say a big thank you to Claire and Richard. I'm really thoroughly enjoying making this character. She is super sweet, and I've really enjoyed bringing her together. The thing we're going to start on now is start and clothe her. So I'm going to start on her undergarments first, and we're going to be making her bloomers today. So if you want to grab your kit and grab your fabric, this beautiful pink that came in the kit, it's all labelled up for you as bloomers on there. Don't you just love the little labels? And so we'll be able to get started on that. So I'll talk to you about what I've had to do to the pattern, because the pattern doesn't come with any seam allowance on it as per professional tailoring standards. But as a home and domestic sewer, then I like my seam allowance on, drawn onto my pattern. But I'm going to go through all of that. We're going to cut it out, we're going to get them sewn up, and then we're going to get them popped onto Clara and protect her modesty. So let's get started. Okay, so the first thing you're going to need to do is go and get your Clara the Cat pattern from out of your packet, your kit. And then I'm going to apologise, because I've already drawn on my copy, because I thought I'd press record and I hadn't. So my apologies. So what I wanted to show you was that when you first get this pattern piece out, you will see that each of them have a solid line. And that's actually your stitching line. This one is for the pinafore, but just for example, because I've messed that one up with having the seam allowance put on it already. And this is the stitching line. And in professional tailoring world, you'll have a stitching line that you'll mark onto your fabric, and then you'll then rough cut it out on the around the outside, and then you'll join your stitching lines together with tacking and then sew round it. But I come from a domestic or home sewing environment, and I'm used to working with seam allowance. So what I've done is, with each of these pieces, as I've been working through them, is I've started to add seam allowance onto them so that I can make a tissue paper pattern rather than using the thicker photocopier paper, which I find I struggle with on my fabric. So what I wanted to just to show you was how I get the seam allowance on, so it gives me a line then that I can copy. On the straight lines, it's easy enough. I just find the 1/4 inch mark on my measuring gauge, in this case it's my seam gauge, and I rest that against the sewing line that's on the pattern, and then I'll make a mark. And then I'll go to the other end of the straight line and I'll make a mark, and I'll just join those two together. Just extend it a little bit way across, so it doesn't matter too much if it's extended too far. And that will then give you the seam allowance on all of the straight pieces. Here we've got a straight piece, but it's a fold line. So I've just put a note to myself, no seam allowance here. And I would suggest you do the same, so you remember that you don't need to add any seam allowance onto this. It doesn't matter too much on bloomers, they'd just be a little bit fuller. But on something like the bodice or the pinafore, if it was on a fold and then you didn't copy that across, then you would then perhaps get that into the wrong size, and that would make a big difference to your finished garment. So have a look at your pieces, see where your fold line is, just mark it if you need to, And then on your straight edges, you're going to then add your seam allowance 1/4 inch by just putting a mark at the top of the bottom and then joining those lines together. On a curve, it's slightly different. It's the same process, but it's just a slightly different technique. So you're going to put your measure of your mark onto the line, sewing line, and make a mark. And then you're going to move across a little way. So this is for a curve, and you're going to do a little line again. And then as you move around the curve, you're going to try and keep the edge of your seam gauge or your ruler equal level with the part, just a small part of the sewing line that you're copying. I'm trying to think what words I need to use then. Did you hear me? Stop and have a think. So again, just do those little marks all the way around like this, but move your seam gauge around as you're going down. And then I just then draw in the straight line as I can. And then when it comes to the curve, I just freehand that curve in so that you can then have that curve mirroring. So this here, and I write in it as well, 1/4 inch seam allowance. So we've got that noted. So that's what you need to do, is just keep putting that down and putting that around in order that you can then have that seam allowance onto your pattern piece. The next thing that I do then is I get my tissue paper, and I get this just from a arts and crafts shop. It's quite readily available. Lay it over the top of my piece, and I then trace out the actual outside line that I've just drawn, which is the pattern piece inclusive of the seam allowance. I draw on it my grain line as well, and then I write on it that that's a fold line, so I remember. And then the bloomers and cut two. I have put on the stitching line, but I don't always do that. It just depends. But I then would need to remember it. And here I wanted to make sure I'd remembered that I'd already put that seam allowance on. And once you've got that, I then feel you've got a pattern piece that you can then use with your characters. So let me grab my fabric, which I've got just here out of the kit, and it's got the bloomers label on it. And then I've ironed that to get the creases out, and then we're ready to start. So when we're having a look at our fabric, I want you to be aware of looking for your selvage edge. So your selvage edge is where it's bound. If I show you from that side, you can probably see it a bit easier. So there's often a frayed edge, but there's this like bound, stiffer little edge, and that's where it's more densely woven, and that's where the fabric is pulled onto the reels, ready for printing the colours onto the fabric. And you can have it with plain fabric as well as with patterned fabric, but we don't want to ever sew with that, because I don't know if you can see that it's kind of got some puckering to it, and that's what's happened when I've ironed it. And sometimes when we wash our fabrics as well, if we were ever to wash these garments, I mean this is the same for all dressmaking, then sometimes that can pucker up even more and it'll distort your fabrics. So just be aware of when you first start getting your fabrics around out of your kit, or if you're working with them anyway, we don't sew with the selvage edge. We always avoid that if we're cutting out. So let's go on to our little bit of our label here. I'm going to just very carefully take off our label because we don't need that now. We know we're working on the bloomers. And this side I haven't got a selvage edge, so I'm probably going to start with that edge first, and I'm going to work on the reverse side, and I'm going to put my folded edge against the folded edge of the fabric. And I want to make sure that we're pretty much as close as we can be. I don't like wasted fabric. I'm a real stickler for not wasting fabric. So we're going to put that on there and make sure that that's all lined up properly. And we can look at the actual grain within the fabric, and we can see how that is in terms of where the lines are going down and going across for the warp and the weft. But we just need to then just be aware, and this has been cut really nicely. So that looks nice and straight. And just on your folded edge, you'll kind of see if the lines start to go off towards the edge. And that's something to be aware of. And try and have your fabric straight. If we're working with a fold, we don't need to worry too much about the grain line, as long as we've tried to keep those edges just right. And I'm going to put my top edge against the top and my folded edge against the fold and make sure that we've got it all even. And then when we have, I'm going to start and pin my pattern piece to the fabric. So I usually fold on a fold line. I usually pin top and bottom of my fold first, just so that holds that nice and level. And you want your edge of your pattern piece to be on the edge of the fabric all the way down there, as long as you've got a straight line, which hopefully you have. And then we can then start and fill in other pins then that are going to help us cut these out accurately. because they're tiny, aren't they? So we need them all to be accurate. Okay, it's a lovely quality fabric we're using as well in these kits. Okay, so that's my pattern piece on, and I need to cut two of these, but cut two on the fold. So this is going to be my first one, and then I'll work down. So we're going to have some nice fabric left over as well, which will be great. So we can use that for some other parts, can't we, later on. So let me get my scissors. And then we're ready to start snipping. The person who doesn't want to waste the fabric in me wants to leave that little bit on the bottom there, but I will cut it off so that it's right to size so you can see exactly how this is. Just take your time working around your curve. And if you need to, just sort of cut it off a bit roughly first, because we can also always finesse it as we're going around. Let's keep our fabric flat on our table so that we can work through that nicely. And I'm just going to take off that little slither at the top, just so that it's all nice and level and even. Try not to cut any off your actual paper pattern. And then we're going to do the same on the bottom down here as well. So just hold your fabric down and run your scissors along your work surface. Try to avoid cutting up here in your hand, because that can be a little bit difficult and mean that you don't quite get a neat cut. Okay, and there we go. That's all fine on there for that one. And then I can fold this over again and just take this pattern piece off. And lost a pin. And I'm going to repeat the process in order to cut out the bloomers. And if this is your first ever doll making video, you may never have worked with fabric before like this. So we do that's why I'm just going over this in quite a lot of detail, just so that you know how to do these things. And I'm actually going to turn the pattern piece over because I can actually save some fabric. Look at this, you see, this is Mrs. Frugal. So let's make sure I get this all straight first. Get those lines straight on that line there. And then I could probably go a little bit further across again. So I'm just making sure, seeing where my pattern will go in terms of my fabric, right to the edge there and right to the edge there. And then I can pop my pins in order just to hold this again. So I've just flipped my pattern piece over. It doesn't matter on this because we're cutting out two mirrored copies. So it doesn't matter, or just two copies of the same piece. And then once I've got that lined on, then see how much fabric we're going to be saving over here. That's great. We can use that for another project then, can't we? And then I'm then going to then cut out this one as well. Okay, so once you've got your pattern pieces cut out, you should have two identical pieces like this, and the front is the same as the back, so they're identical, they're just symmetrical because we cut them out on the fold, so they're on the same. And you've got your left and your right, these end up being the legs of your bloomers. So the next thing you need to do is have a look in your stash and choose your thread colour. I've got a pink that I can use for that one, but you're also going to have a thread colour for your lace as well, because we're going to lace trim the end of these bloomers as well. So we need to keep that in mind as to what we're using. So get your bobbins and your reels of thread and your colour matched up, but just bear in mind you need a pink and you also need your off-white as well. So let me get my machine set up and then we'll be ready to start and do some we're going to do some pressing first, actually. So let's get our iron sorted and our pressing mat, and we'll be doing some ironing first, and then we'll need some edges and we'll atelier leave as we go along. Hold on. Okay, so the first thing that we're going to be doing is turning up 1/4 inch hem on the bottom of the legs of our trousers. So if you want to get your seam gauge and have the wrong side of your fabric facing upwards and your pins at the ready, then we're going to just take up that 1/4 inch on the bottom of the seam of the legs here. I'm going to measure it. And then the way that I do is I just put a pin in, and quite often you have a fabric ironing board cover, and just by going along and just pinning it up and just putting your pins in at different intervals, you can then iron this without having to keep burning your fingers. Ask me how I learned that bit, because I did. It's very easy done. So let's just pop that down. And again, just there. Okay, so that's got our 1/4 inch seam allowance there. So now, if we want to, we can use a press cloth. So I use a silk organza press cloth if I'm sewing on my fabrics. This quilting cotton should take a good high heat because it often does. But if you wanted to, then you can use a silk organza press cloth just to make sure that it just makes sure no marks come off the bottom of your iron onto the your fabric. It's especially good if you're using a white fabric or a, you know, a white plain fabric. And then just give that a blow just to let that cool off, and then we can take our pins out. And then that will give the garment a little bit of memory for that fold, so that when we come to actually stitch it, we're fine. But what we've done is by folding it up first and ironing it, we make sure that if that we are neatening stitches, alter the width of this at all, we're not going up into our garment anymore. So let's just do exactly the same on the other one. Okay, once we've got those both ironed into that position, then we can move our ironing mat out of the way and bring our sewing machine in, because we're going to do a zigzag stitch along the edge of these. If you've got an overlocker, then you can use an overlocker. But we're just going to do a neatening stitch just to neaten this off. So we're going to zig in the fabric, but we're going to then zig off the fabric so that that just neatens that edge. But sometimes you need to just reduce your tension down so it doesn't bunch it all up. It all depends on how your machine is. So let me choose my right stitch, which is number 8 on mine, and I've got a width of 5, so I'm going to take that down probably to a width of 3, and then the stitch length is 2. I'll leave that at that. So I'm on the zigzag stitch. I've got a stitch width of 3 and a stitch length of 2. So let's just go ahead and just neaten off the edge of these. And I'll show you afterwards how that stitch is. And this will just prevent all of those threads from where the fabric's been cut from over time just coming loose from the fabric. And we can just do what's called chain piecing. So once we've come off one, because these are just straight edges, we can just feed the other one in and go straight from one straight onto the other. Okay, when we're finished, we can stop. I always lose everything. And take our threads off, that's our press cloth out of the way. Just snip them in between. And then just take off your starting thread. And then the next thing that I do is anything where you've got what I call a whisker, which is hanging off like this, just go back and just neaten those off. Because don't need any of those. Just be careful not to go through any of your stitches. And then if you can see, that zigzag is right on the edge there. Perhaps if I go from that side, you'll be able to see. So right on the edge. It just neatens that edge. I've not got so many whiskers. Oh, we have a couple here. Just neatens that edge, and it just makes sure that no more threads are going to come off. If you've not got a zigzag stitch on your machine, then you could always use your pinking shears like these and just go along. But just be careful not to take too much off, because you've not got much of a seam allowance there, and so we don't want to lose that. So the next thing then that we're going to do, neaten at the edge, we're going to turn up and add the lace. And it depends whether or not you want your lace over the edge of your trousers or not, or whether you want them onto the edge of your trousers. Hard to tell, isn't it, what we might do. Oh, I've not got the original here to be able to see and cross-reference. Maybe just hanging half on and half off like that so that you can see through the lace on the end. So I'll probably do mine like that. So let's get some pins. A little bit of a design choice there. So the options are either like that, or you could have your lace so that it's absolutely on the bottom of your, so you've got no overhang at all. Or you can do halfway between the two and just have the very edge, scalloped edge, just going off the end there. Well, that's pretty too, isn't it? Oh gosh, maybe I'll do mine like that, because that's then going to be nice, isn't it? So what I'm going to do is I'm pinning this down now. I haven't sewn my hem up yet, because we're going to do it all in one go. So my pins are just catching the hem down. But my little scalloped edge is just going just off the edge, just like that, look. And then once we get to the end of the trouser, we're going to need to snip that. Try not to waste any of your ribbon, because we need this for the bottom of the skirt as well, don't we? So we need to have enough for that. So then the next thing then that we can do is take this over to the sewing machine. Now, because we're top stitching this lace on, then I would suggest that you actually change your thread now. So change your top thread. So the bobbin's thread can still be pink because you'll be sewing your hem down. But the top thread I'm going to change now for my off-white. Okay, that's ready to go. So then we can take this now, go down to the bottom here. And what am I going to try? Do a zigzag stitch, or shall we do a straight stitch? So I've actually got a three-step zigzag on my machine. It looks like this. Whoops, maybe I'll turn them off. See if I can catch that. I'll zoom in for you. So that's my three-step zigzag just there. I think we're going to use that stitch because that will do a zigzag, but it'll put those stitches in. So let me just move that on to stitch number 9. And then it's automatically set up at 5. I'm going to change that down to a 2.5 and a stitch length of 1. That should probably do. Okay, so let's just have a go with this. We can always do it on a test first to see if it works. No, we need to be on a higher. On a stitch length, that's better. I'll hand sew that one down slightly because it's not quite caught the hem just there. So maybe you may be better just going down and putting a row of stitches through your hem first. Okay, so once you've got everything all neatened off, and I've just finished neatening it off mine as well, so that's all done now. Got a few little threads just here or there. The next thing we're going to do then is measure 2 centimetres from the bottom of your lace. And I'm just going to do a little dot with my Frixion pen. It'll just give me something to aim for. I'm not going to draw a full line in, just in case the fabric ink doesn't wash out. But this is going to give us a line because we're going to do a row of zigzag stitches along this line. And that will just then help us just make sure that you can jump from one dot to the other on your machine, okay? And we'll do that on both of these, okay? And then you're now going to make sure you've got your pink thread in top and at the bottom, because we're going to be sewing onto our pink fabric now for the rest of these, the construction of these short bloomers. Doesn't take long, does it, just to change the thread and get that really good finish. Okay, so then what we're going to do now is put us back onto a zigzag stitch, and we want quite a wide one. So mine's set at 5 on the width and at 2 on the length, so that should be fine. And I'm going to line up the centre of my zigzag, so it's going to go down the centre of the line that of the dots that I've just drawn. And then it's going to start off a little, just anchor the thread through first on my stitch. If not, just do a couple of stitches backwards and forwards just to do that. And then I'm putting my dots into the middle of my presser foot. And then I'm just going to reverse at the end. You can either reverse at the end, or you can just anchor your threads if you've got a stitch that does that. Okay. Take those threads off at the start and finish. Keep everything all nice and neat. So that's what it looks like when you've got those stitches there. Okay. Front and back. Mine's just gathered in slightly, but that's the nature of a zigzag stitch. It does tend to want to gather in a little bit. Okay. So the next thing then that we're going to do, according to the instructions, is we're going to put one on top of the other. I'll just take off that thread there. Tell you what we'll do, I'm thinking ahead. We're going to put the elastic in soon. So I think that what I'm going to do is I'm going to press down the amount that we need to do on the waist yet. Turn the upper edge twice to create a... Right, okay, so I'm going to press down just over half an inch, probably 3/4 of an inch on this top edge. Let me just get my ironing things. And we'll do what we did before with the pins, just to hold that in place. And what this is going to do is just going to give that memory to this fabric so we can then work with it in a second. So I'm going to do 3/4 of an inch because that will give us enough then to turn it under twice and get our elastic through. So let's measure 3/4 of an inch. So 3/4 of an inch is 2 centimetres. I kind of flit between centimetres and inches, so forgive me, sorry. And put those pins in as well as you're just going along, and that will just help keep everything in place for you whilst you're ironing that edge. So I usually iron it at the full amount first, give it a blow to dry that off, and then what we can do is we can then tuck that under to the line and then fold it over. Make sure that's a nice edge and just press that down. Okay, let's do the same on this one. So here's Clara. And let's just have a look if she has that between her legs. Is that going to be enough of a waist for her, bearing in mind that the seam allowance will take some up? Yeah, I think that's going to be fine. So 2 centimetres, and you'll be able to see from mine. And I'll put a note on the video as well if I added any extra seam allowance onto the top of my cutting out when I was cutting these out in the end, because that's the benefit of me having made this first. You can learn from what I've done. Right, make sure that's all flat and cool, and then you can open this out again, because now we're going to pop these on top of each other like that, and then on these two curved edges here we're going to line up the waistband first and make sure it's unfolded, because you need it to be folded out flat. We'll turn it over later. And then go to your crotch point, and you're going to then put your pin in there, and then put a couple more in between just to make sure this is all going to stay together as you jump from one to the other. That's it. Let's use our sewing machine. So we're going to take it onto a straight stitch now. We're just going to use the 2.2 dressmaking construction stitch. That should be fine, and we've got 1/4 of an inch seam allowance. And the way that I measure that with my machine is you can see where the needle is, and then I take my measure and I put my measure behind my needle and then see if I need to move it across at all, and I do until the 1/4 inch seam allowance is in line with the edge of the presser foot, and then I'm happy. Okay, and then I know, so if position 6.5 on my machine gives me my 1/4 of an inch seam allowance, and then I can put the edge of my presser foot against my work, and I know that I've got that in place. So let's put anything in our work to hold it, and then we're going to use the edge of the presser foot to then keep track of where we are. Coming up to a pin, so let's take that out. Then coming up to another pin, and we're also coming up to a curve, so we're going to have to do that pivoting thing again, where we leave our needle in the work, we take a few stitches forward until the fabric starts to leave the side of our presser foot, and then we're going to start and just do a few stitches at a time as we just turn around this curve. Oh, and I lifted my presser foot up then by mistake, without having my needle in the work. So you get a jog if you're not careful. Let's keep going, and I'll show you what that's done to the detail. And we can reverse at the end there. Needle out of the work. So what happens is, if you've not got your needle in your work, can you see that little jog just there in the stitches? That's what happened. That one won't matter because it's so much, because it's between the legs. But if it was on a collar or on a neckline, I would definitely change that and go over it again just to make sure that it's right. So let's go to the other end, and let's put our raw edges together at our waist edge. And we're going to do just exactly the same as we have done without the jogging the stitches. Okay, the other thing that we're going to do then now is we're going to neaten this edge here by doing a zigzag stitch. So let's go back to our zigzag. And and I had a stitch width of 3, didn't I, and a stitch length of 2. So let's just pop that on and let's just do this. Needling the work for while we pivot around that corner. Just make sure your needle's in your work. Needle out, that'll do nicely for there. And again, if you get any little whiskers after you've zigzagged, just go along and just take those off. It really does just neaten that line of stitching up quite nicely. That's it. Let's go on to the other side and do the other curved edge that we've just been doing. Okay. So we've now got our trousers, our bloomers in the round. The other thing that I'm going to do is just take a moment just to tack down with some tacking thread the elastic, the seam allowance at the elastic casing point, because experience has told me that on these small garments it's easy to get your, well, you'll see what we'll see when we get there, but trust me, just take a few moments now just to load up your tacking thread. It doesn't matter whether you push them to the right or the left, just take your thread and just do some fairly small stitches and just attach the seam allowance where you've just zigzagged it down at that seam point. And sometimes you can do a few stitches together. Okay. Just do a double stitch at the end just to hold on to that thread. And snip it off. Got another thread caught in it from the waist lug. So, just go and do the other side. Snip that off. Okay, just a little extra step, but I think that will help us when we turn the casing over and then we're going to thread a safety pin through with the elastic on. And we need to be able to not get caught on the seam allowance. So it'll tell us which way round the seam allowance is, but it'll just hold it flat for us, that need, that so safety pin can get through. Okay, so the next thing then that we're going to do then is now go back down to our hem edges. And we're now going to put our hem edges together. So let's match up the edges of our lace and put a pin in. Let's go to our seam point, and I would suggest you put one seam allowance one way and one seam allowance the other way, because then you'll be able to get those seams really closely together. And just put your finger over them, just make sure they're lying nice and flat. And let's put a pin right at that point just there. And then we're going to go to the other end of the leg and we're going to put our lace on top of each other. And we're going to put another pin in just there. Oops. Because now we're going to put this in the sewing machine, start here, 1/4 inch seam allowance, and sew all the way along there. So let's take it off a zigzag stitch before I start stitching. Back onto stitch number one. I'm going to take a few stitches forward and a few stitches back just to anchor that. Put our needle in our work so that we can then be hands-free. Okay, so let's go down to this point here. I'm going to stop on that stitching, the point at the centre between the legs where we stitched. So let's just, we've got those previous stitch line. So we're coming up to it with our pin, so very carefully take that out, right on top of that stitching. And now I'm going to lift up my presser foot and pivot my sewing so that we can then come down the other leg. As we come down to the lace down here, I'm just going to reverse, just to set that off. Needle out of your work, and let's just snip those threads off. And our starting threads too. And then we're going to switch ourselves back onto a zigzag stitch, and now we're going to just go over the edge of these. Try not to go over too much over the edge of your ribbon, because you might, you shouldn't see it on the outside, but I'll show you how we kind of deal with that bit so that you don't see it on the outside. But you can just flatten out your between the legs and just sew all the way down. Just reverse on the edge. And again, we're just going to take off our threads and any whiskers that we've got from those that zigzagging and take off our starting threads as well. So let's just have a little recap of where we are. So the first seam we sewed was this the crotch seam along here, and we've neatened that. And then we've put the two hem edges together. So now we've created our legs with our circles of our lace around, and then we've sewn through the middle of there and we've zigzagged on that. The next thing that I tend to do is I will just maybe catch that down by hand actually, because otherwise I'm going to be putting pink thread onto our lace, and I don't want that because it's all about the finish with these, isn't it? So let's just push this lace here just to the side, and I'm just going to put a couple of little stitches through that seam allowance, that zigzag seam allowance, to just hold that in place against the hem. And the idea is that you don't get any of your pink stitches on the pink thread on the other side of your bloomers, just to keep that really nice and neat. Okay, and it just holds that seam allowance down and just stops it from poking out. Take that thread off, and it literally takes just a few seconds, doesn't it, just to do this kind of thing. But I think the finishing touches are what elevate everything. So if you're not happy with the finish that you're getting, I'm going to put the other one the same way. So pushing the seam allowance, so I'll push that one towards the right. I'm going to push this one towards the right as well. And if you've not been happy with the finish of with your made garments, then just taking that little bit of time just to concentrate on the finish makes a huge difference. Okay. So there we go. Let's just do a few stitches there, and you can't see that on the other side, so that's perfect, and that's all it needed just to hold that down. So the next thing then that we're going to do now is we are going to fold over our hem. Can you see we've got our ironed in lines? Can you see those? Hopefully you can. So we're going to turn that over once, and it's got that memory in it, and we're going to turn it over again, and then we're going to put a pin in. It's a double turn on that waistband, isn't it? Makes it quite easy. Much easier to have ironed in those crease marks whilst the bloomers were in the flat than it is when you try and sew them once they're in the round. Once they're connected all together, if you've got any long threads, just take those off. It's just the fabric fraying slightly, which you're going to need to knit all off inside in a moment. So that's all done. Okay, so there we go. They're all pinned on the top there, all beautifully. So the next thing we're going to do now is decide which is the front and the back of our garment. So this is going to be the back, because the seam allowance is going to the back on the legs that I just tacked back. And then either side of the seam allowance here, I'm going to leave that open. So let me put my red pins in to remind me. So there's an extra pin there just to remind me, and an extra pin here to remind me to stop, because we need somewhere for the actual safety pin to go in and out, and that little gap there will just be enough to feed it in and feed it round with our elastic on. All will make sense. The next thing I suggest you do is turn your bloomers the right way round. So they're all ready. And then we're going to feed these under the presser foot. We're going to start at the first red pin, and we're going to then stitch so that we're just, let me just show you with my pick and pick here. We're going to be stitching down towards this bottom edge just here, so it's really going to practice your top stitching skills. We don't want to be in the middle here, because we need this distance here for our elastic to go through, to be threaded through for our waistband. So we're going to need to go just about an eighth of an inch up from that turned edge just there, which is from the inside of the slit bloomers. That's the word I wanted. Right, let's go on to number two. So I line mine. I've got my machine needle across to the left now, which is great. And I'm going to fold some of this extra bit out of the way. And when you're working on small garments like this, it can be a bit fiddly. But all you need to concentrate on is having the first inch under your presser foot clear. So once you've got that, then you can set off. So now I've got that one, it's under my presser foot. I've taken out the first red pin. So let me just do my two stitches forward and two stitches back just to hold that in place. And then needling the work. So I've done my inch. Now I'm going to roll the garment just slightly towards me, keeping my other pins out of the way. Can you see how that all wants to flick over? And we're just going to do just an inch at a time. So take that pin out as you come to it. Done our next inch, or as far as we can. So let's roll that garment forward again, keeping the pins out of the way. Oops, pins come out. Just make sure everything's lying flat. And then we're going to sew towards this area. And over the seam allowance that we've already put through, because that's not the one we're actually leaving open. And it might need just a little help just to get over. Try not to tug on your bloomers. Then once you've got your next inch or so done, then you can roll your garment again forward towards you. Just stop for your pins and then roll your garment before you as well. And then just roll it forward again. And then we've got our double pin there, so I'll take out the green one and then I'll remember to stop just around about where that red one was. And then I'm just going to just do a reverse stitch there. Needle out of the work. And let's take off our threads. Okay, so this is how they're looking. So that's what it looked like from the inside. You can see that row of stitching just really close to the edge. And then just here, I've got a gap left in there so that we can thread that elastic through. So the next thing that we're going to do is, we are going to get the elastic. Let's see if it says in here about the elastic. Nope, so I'll show you how we measure Clara for her elastic, shall I? That would be a good idea. Let me just get my elastic. Okay, so for this bit, you're going to need some elastic and you're going to need a safety pin. So this elastic, just so that you know, is 0.5 centimetre wide, 1/4 inch wide. And we want to just measure round Clara's tummy as to where these bloomers are going to go, because we don't want them to be too tight, but we need them to be tight enough. So I usually do that, and so take it round her tummy on your character and then just leave a little bit of an uplift so that you've got something to stitch together and overlap. So let me cut that just there. And then let me just measure it and I can tell you how long mine is and you'll know roughly how long yours is. Mine's just over 6 inches. So 6 1/4 to 6 1/2 inches, I think, should be around about what you need to use. And what I then do is take the elastic and I'm going to thread it onto my safety pin. And actually, if you've got another, no, you can use a pin actually. I was going to say, if you've got another elastic pin, you'd be fine. And what I try to do, always try to remember to do, is to attach the end of my seam of my elastic inside my garment with a pin, because it's very easy for you to get excited and start threading through and give it a tug and then it comes out the other end and you only really want to be doing this once. So we're going to be threading our elastic onto our safety pin, feed the head of your elastic in, and then you're going to push on the safety pin and gather the fabric up over the top of the elastic of the safety pin. Then when you've got a few gathers on there, hold on to the edge of the safety pin with one hand and then pull with the other and you'll see you've pulled some elastic in. So again, just push your safety pin through along the waistband, through the channel you've created. Then hold on to it with your finger and thumb. You can see all the gathers there. And then as you pull, the elastic disappears into your garment. And this is the same if you're doing cuffs on sleeves. What else? Waistbands on. You can make a very simple children's skirt with that waistband. And can you see how we're going straight through the join there? If you've ever tried to get elastic through on a join where you've got seam allowance, you'll know how tricky that can be sometimes. So
just keep pushing your safety pin through and round. And then it pokes out the other side. So give it, and it's usually this point here that at which the other end disappears into your garment if it's going to. So that's all going in there. And then what I do then is, holding on to the edge of the elastic, try and work out which way it's been threaded through and which way it's coming out, to try and make sure it's not twisted, especially on a child skirt or something, or an adult skirt. And then I then put the safety pin through both of those together just to hold them for me. So that's what you end up with, the elastic there coming out the top, and then you've got all these gathers into your waistband for your carriage. Let's just try these on and just see if they're, we've got a little bit of extra there that we can use for them, but if it's too tight, then we'd rather know now. Oh no, they fit nicely. I've actually got the back at the front, but I don't mind that at this moment in time whilst we're just doing this. Okay, so that's looking nice. So I know that that's the right width, strength. If I hadn't been able to get these on, or if I'd put them on and they were falling down, now's the time to adjust your elastic. But being as they fit quite nicely, then that's fine. We'll just, you can have them back in a minute, Clara. So now what I do is I'm going to go back to the elastic again where that pin is. I'm going to thread up my hands. Oh, in fact, I've got some pink. Doesn't matter, you're not going to see it anyway. It's going to be inside. So let's just have a little bit of pink on the elastic here, and then you'll be able to see my stitches. And this stitching doesn't need to be neat at all, because you nobody's going to see it. So let's just do a knot on the end here just to start that off. Okay. Now, if you stitch, have your two ends of your elastic together like this and stitch them together, it's going to be quite bulky. So what I suggest you do is actually pull your elastic out of it so that you've got something to play with. So you can see how tightly gathered the bloomers are now. You can check as well to make sure that your elastic hasn't twisted whilst you've been threading it through, by just running your fingers along that waistband, and you should feel a bit of a bulk or a bit of a bump if it has. Just straighten that out if you can do. Just a good practice to get into to doing that. And then let's take our pin off. And now what we're going to do is we're going to take the two ends and try and make sure they're not twisted. And then we're going to lie one end over the top of the other, just like that. Can you see how that's crossed over there? And then just do a few little overstitches on each side, just to hold these together. And as I say, these can be quite chunky stitches, and then I usually do a stitch in the middle as well, just to hold that together. And then just start through on the other side as well. And as I say, this doesn't need to be neat, because it's going to all be completely hidden forever. But you can be as neat as you like. All you're trying to do is just fix the ends of those elastics together so it's not going to come undone. Just making sure I use up all my thread as much as possible. Okay, that's nice. And then snip off your needle, make sure your needle's out of the way. Put your pin to one side, because you'll need that for another garment at some stage. And then if you then pull on the edges of your elastic, you'll see that that elastic will pull the bulk of that into your waistband, so that it's out of the way. Got a little thread there, let's just take that off. And that's just pulled that into there, and you can now just neaten your edges across. And then we're going to go back to the sewing machine. We're going to just smooth those gathers away from that centre part, and we're just going to seal this shut now. That's why we needed just to try them on her first, to make sure that they were ready. Okay, and what we want to try and do is move the elastic so it's up to the top of the waistband at the top here, so that when we stitch through this, we don't stitch through the elastic. That is the theory. So right on the edge, let's do a few stitches forward and a few stitches back, just on a straight stitch. That should have that held together quite nicely. And then the next thing that we can do then is, now that we've finished threading our elastic, is we can just remove our tacking stitches that we put in when we were doing the other stitching, didn't we, just to hold that seam allowance down. Okay, so that stitching is invisible on this side. Okay, one more step to do, and that is just to turn your bloomers back round the right way round. The wrong way round. And then we're going to just put some elastic, some shearing elastic through here. Let me just get my shearing elastic. Mine's really quite old. I probably could have done with some new for this project, but I'm using what's in my stash. So just take a decent amount. So I'll probably need to go around a couple of times. And then I'm going to use a darning needle, which is like this, because it's got a blunt point on it. Use them for knitting up jumpers and things like that. And then I'm going to put my shearing elastic, thread it onto my needle. Let's just tie a knot in the end there for now. Okay. Then starting at the seam allowance edge here, we're going to start on the inside, we're going to thread this needle through the back of those zigzag stitches. Can you see how I'm doing that? You can see the threads going over the top of the needle. I'll probably only be able to do so far, and then we'll have to pull it through. I'm leaving an end at the moment so that we can then pull that tight in a minute. And then just go back in again without missing any bits of thread if you can. Pull it through again. It's going to give it a nice little gentle gather, isn't it? And just be careful you've not cut your elastic too short that you're going to go off the edge again. You don't want to do that. Okay. So just be careful, because you've got a needle on elastic that's going to ping around a bit if you're not careful. And now we're going to pull the elastic through and see how that's going to gather up. Oh, that gathers up quite nicely actually. And then let's just thread off our knot. I'm going to do three knots just so that's sure. And then I'm just going to thread the end of the shearing elastic through a few more of the stitches just to hold it for me before I snip it off that way. And then I can use my needle to thread the ends of the elastic on this way and thread that the other way. And then that will just keep those ends just so that they can't unravel. Okay, just pull that through there. And just snip off the end. So that makes that nice and neat. So there's that leg done now. So I'm just going to go on now and do the other leg, and I'll come back to you when I'm about to try them on. Okay, so I've just finished my adding my shearing elastic. I'm just going to turn my bloomers the right way round. Find out which is the back, which is the bit that we overstitched, and then put those over her feet. I'm just going to pull those up. Make sure they're comfy around the back. Make sure that elastic is sitting nice and flat on her waist, which it is. There we go. Get the front seam of the bloomers on the front seam of her. And then we can just pull these down, can't we, to make sure that they're just nice as well, just all sitting nicely. The back seam is on the right place on the back. And there we go. There's Clara in her bloomers. So she looks nice and comfy in those, doesn't she? Okay, let me turn the camera around and we'll have a roundup.
Okay, so here's Clara in her lovely bloomers again, all ready for the next stage of her outfit. And I actually think I'm going to do her bonnet next. Obviously it's up to you. By the time you get to watch these, hopefully all of the parts will be loaded up for you. But my thought process is that if I start with the dress and the pinafore, I'm going to want it to be finished immediately. So I'm starting with the bloomers first and then her bonnet, so that then when we do her dress and her pinafore, she's all fully dressed then and raring to go. Obviously I've still got to just attach her ears, but as we said in the earlier videos of construction, I just want to check where her bonnet's going to fit on first before I start to attach those. So that's why they look a little bit peculiar and are just pinned on. But yeah, there's the lovely, lovely coordinating bloomers for her. So I hope you've enjoyed stitching with me today. If you have, I'd love it if you'd consider subscribing to my channel. If you have enjoyed the video, then please click the like button as well, because that really helps my channel just get pushed out to more people. And if you wanted to leave me a comment, if you think there's something that I could do better or something that you've particularly liked about the video, then I'd love to hear that from you. And I always answer the comments as well, so please do feel free to leave a comment and let's have a chat about them. Okay. Thank you very much to everybody for watching. Thank you to Claire and Richard from Lily Rose Dolls for sponsoring the kit for me. And I'll get on with making a bonnet. Have a great day, everybody. Bye.